Boom.
The official podcast of the waterfront capital of Texas.
We running this, let's go.
I'm on a boat, I'm on a boat. Everybody look at me, cause I'm sailing on a boat. I'm on a boat.
Weekends on the Water with Jordan Davlin of Jet Surf Houston and Scene Magazine publisher John Ennis.
That is right. This is Weekends in the Water, and we're coming to you live with episode 2 of season 4 from the 4,000 square foot Jet Surf Houston studio and showroom along the north shore of Clear Lake in the heart of the waterfront capital of Texas. My name is John Ennis, and as always, I'm proud to be joined by Army veteran, extreme water sports competitor, and Jet Surf Houston founder, Jordan Davlin. How goes it, Jordan?
Yo. What's up, John? How are you, man?
Man, doing great, and I'm glad we took it. We waited to start the show for a little bit because we wanted to watch the sunset tonight,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it was another amazing one. Man, too many.
We're spoiled.
We are, yeah.
Man,
yeah.
Right here along the waterfront capital of Texas in October. I always say March and October are my two favorite months of the year because of the weather. And because it's October, I'm going with October as my favorite month of the year. But, we're really getting treated to some beautiful weather right now. Blue skies, beautiful sunsets, blue water, you know, just enough of a breeze to really feel good. This is the payoff for living here, man.
It's nice. Yeah, the water's cooling off. Feels great to get in. The weather's cooling down. Like you said, breeze. Sunsets have been amazing. There hasn't been a lot of rain. It's been beautiful. Yeah, we really are blessed to be over here in Seabrook on the North Shore, man.
Yes, we are. And so last week we did what turned out to be a two-hour episode.
Woo!
Yeah, we touched on much of the recently announced waterfront developing happening along the many coastlines in our beautiful area. I think we covered at least 8 different cities, including right here in Seabrook. And then, just in this immediate area and all the way down towards the coast, towards Galveston and on Galveston.
I was going to say every city around Clear Lake for sure. But then we also went all the way down to Galveston. I mean, we really did. Yeah. We hit everything, you know.
And we even went across to the to Bolivar too, I believe, right? Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah. So we covered a lot of ground. I don't know if this show will be 2 hours, but
it will not.
But since we're now in October, which I always call October like the for this area, October's like event month, you know, and it's partly because of the weather. And, but this is really the first year in a couple years where I feel like we really, it's a true event month, a true October, because everything's back to normal now.
100%. Back to normal, open, people are having a good time, cooling off. I mean, this is the prime time fall season since COVID, for sure.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, let's be honest. I mean, last year, we are in Texas, and we like to, we sometimes, I wouldn't say we don't follow rules, but we like our events. We don't let anything kind of keep us from doing what we want to do and getting outside and enjoying events. So, last October, there was a number of events. Actually, I can only think of one major event, which we are going to discuss tonight, that actually was still on even in 2020. And that's a little tease for later. I decided that today maybe be a good time to talk about all the events that are coming up. Obviously we won't cover them all, but we'll select some events that are starting. And we're gonna start one that's kind of we're here in Seabrook right now. There's one that's kind of it doesn't actually take place in Seabrook, but it's headquarters in Seabrook and it starts in Seabrook. In that majority of the boats are docked in Seabrook. And that is the 35th annual Harvest Moon Regatta, which actually starts tomorrow.
Yes.
Yeah. So, the Harvest Moon Regatta, it's like I said, this is the 35th annual race. I did it. I crewed, gosh, I want to say 2000. So, 22 years ago, which, truthfully, at that point, I thought the race was very well established. I didn't realize that the last time I sailed was more than half the 35 years ago.
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah, I guess I truly am getting old. But so every year the Harvest, and they've done it every year since I think it's what, 87. Yeah, back in 87 they had 17 yachts.
Now you're making me feel old. Yeah. That I'm older than that. So.
Well, it's okay. I mean, you know, because really, if you would have asked me, I would have, you know, I mean, I guess I remember, you know, doing special events when it turned 20 and 25 and 30 even. But, you know, if you would have asked me probably before I reminded myself about it, you know, I probably would have told you the Harvest Moon Regatta has been around for 40 plus years.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So it's so. But anyway, 35 years. It has been for a long time. It's been classified as the longest port-to-port race in North America.
Okay.
I don't know if that's still true because, truthfully, I couldn't find any reference to that, you know, in the last couple of years. It wouldn't surprise me if some races come up in the last, you know, obviously 35 years that might be longer. The Harvest Moon Regatta, it always starts on a Thursday. And the starting line is what used to be the old, and was when I was on, you know, when I crewed, it was the old Flagship Hotel, which, of course, now is the Pleasure Pier.
Yeah.
You know, the Landry's owned.
We've talked about has so much history.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, yeah. Prior to the Flagship, prior, I mean, there's been, that pier is old, and there's a lot of, I mean, people have immigrated into the United States on that pier.
That's awesome. There's so much history in Galveston.
All over the world. Yeah, yeah, literally, that was an immigration pier. Like in the 30s and 40s. I mean, it's amazing. Anyways, continue.
So it starts Thursday. The actual starting gun is usually right around 2 p.m. And it goes from Galveston. It's roughly 140 mile race from Galveston to Port Aransas. Wow. With a big, huge party sponsored by Bacardi Rum at the end on Saturday. And a couple takeaways I'll tell you from my experience.
Where's it in, John, you said?
At Port Aransas.
Okay, yeah, so yeah. Port A, and they got a big party down in Port A.
They have a big party down there. I was impressed with how many people drive down there just for the party.
I might drive down there for the
right,
party.
Right, right. I mean, it is, they, you know, it's a good time. The other thing is just how, you know, and if you're free tomorrow, you know, around 2 o'clock, you know, or probably, you know, try to get out there a little bit earlier than that to get a good spot. It's really impressive, and I know it's even more impressive from the water, but it's impressive to watch these boats because they have to kind of move around and go back and forth because they have to be on the correct side of the Pleasure Pier when they get there, you know, and of course there's multiple starts for different classifications.
Sure.
But when that you know, starting gun goes off at 2, you really want to be caught, you know, and behind the starting line, but with a nice little, you know, with you know, already with momentum going, you know, going heading west, we'll say. And it was, the year I accrued, I was just amazed by all this close corner back and forth and maneuvering and boats avoiding each other. I mean, it's really amazing.
Just to get set up on the starting line.
Just to get a correct start. Yeah, I mean, well, you know, and I guess it happens in other sports. I mean, obviously this isn't, you know, this isn't an auto sport where you can just, you know, be stopped. You know, there's a sailboat.
Well, they have to warm up their cars and their tires and stuff too. And do a few laps before they, I think they get kind of lined up. They don't just like come off the
cold
the
start
with an engine ready to start the race. Well, so I think there's some stuff to that.
Yeah,
as well,
but if you can imagine a sailboat. Boat, you know,
harder.
Yeah, it's not a cold start. I mean, you're it's a moving start, and you have to be in the right place. And if you happen to be in front, you have to then go behind it and get, you know, make sure you get back to, you know, the proper starting position, and then carry on forward. And of course, the other thing that surprised me is the amount of damage to these boats that happen every year. You know, I guess I really have a from everything. So the one year I did it, one boat got demasted out in the bay before even making it to the starting line. So, I mean, demasted. I mean, they lost their mast.
How does that happen?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I mean, like, I've never seen a boat, like, get demasted.
Right, I've only seen one. It was not pretty. We tore a sail before we, you know, out kind of, we were a little beyond, well, we were in the bay because we were still kind of south, you know, right around Texas City area, but we tore a sail before we even got to the starting line. So we had to, and the funny thing is we were all drinking, we got a head start on the drinking, and drinking warm Coors Light.
Naturally. Yeah,
warm Coors Light, which, you know, even back then that wasn't something I enjoyed. I mean, you know, no
warm as the Rockies in the summer.
I know there's a lot of, you know, a lot of people love Coors Light, you know, and I'm not a beer snob. Well, I guess maybe I am, but yeah. So anyway, but we had to replace a a sale before we even got to the starting line, and that pretty much, you know, that was quite a task. I quickly learned that I literally am crewing. I'm not along for the ride.
Learn how to like fix a sale on the spot, huh?
Yeah. Well, I followed directions. I definitely Well, I quickly learned this wasn't a party cruise. Mm-hmm. You know, this was work, and
there's jobs. Everybody's got a job here.
Yeah, so just a really cool event. Like I said, it's known nationally. You know, it has been considered the longest port to port race in North America. You know, I'm not going to go on record saying it still is. You know, but it's
me and John never go on record.
Well, we try to
never. No,
we try to be. We try to. You know, we try to at least have multiple sources if we're going to say something. Yeah, you know. But you know, it started. It was kind of something that just started. The story is that and of course, this is kind of put on the organizing bodies, the Lakewood Yacht Club, right across the street here in Seabrook, one of the top yacht clubs in the country, especially, you know, in regards to sailing, competitive sailing.
Truly is. Yeah, just sure by location and where we're.
Yeah, I mean, we're really blessed. We have, you know, two of the top sailing-related yacht clubs between Lakewood and the Houston Yacht Club. I mean, two, you know, top-notch yacht clubs. Obviously, we also have the Corinthian Yacht Club, too.
And there's even two other ones as well. But, you know, those are definitely the main ones that are on the, like, you know, I mean, arguably the world stage. And, you know, people have, you know, been members of these different yacht clubs and have been a part of these different organizations and you know, I mean, sailed the world. And so I feel like they talk about these things when, you know, when they start sailing at a place like Lakewood Yacht Club and then they're sailing across the world and they're talking about different places and you know, I think people know about it.
Yeah, but the concept allegedly came up when a bunch of members of the Lakewood Yacht Club were in the bar, Lakewood, you know, at the club drinking Bacardi. They thought, wouldn't it be great to race down to Port A, you know, do it on a Thursday, so, you know, and then come, you know, so, you know, maybe have it start on a Thursday, so, you know, the amount of work missed would be minimal, and the rest is history. And of course, now it's been sponsored by Bacardi for ever since I can remember. The top prize is the Bacardi Cup.
So Bacardi is the official sponsor.
Yeah, they are an official sponsor, and the Bacardi Cup's awarded to the first place ORC Spinnaker boat in the racing fleet.
I want to go more into this Bacardi thing real quick.
Okay,
we love talking about alcohol too.
Yes.
You said that who was at the Lakewood Yacht Club drinking Bacardi or just
it was some members.
Were they Bacardi reps or did
I think they're members. Yeah.
They just reached out to Bacardi and said, "We're drinking Bacardi, we want to do a Bacardi race."
Whether this happened, you know, I doubt Bacardi was a sponsor the first year when they had 17 boats. Okay. But now it's grown up to there's been years where it's had over 260 yachts. Yeah, so it's turned into a really, you know, and Bacardi, you know, definitely kind of, I'd say, upscale brand, you know, kind of sailing, you know, Caribbean. I mean, kind of works. I mean, obviously, a lot of rum. Something about sailing and rum, right? Water sports and rum. So the Bacardi Cup is one of the prizes. There's actually multiple prizes. I mean, there's memorial trophies. There's the first to finish prize. There's the Luna Trophy, which is geared to encourage women in yacht racing. And awarded to the cruising non-spinnaker fleet based on the lowest corrected time to a boat whose skipper and primary crew are women. So, you know, there could be, I guess there could be at least
definitely
one male.
Respect a woman that can, you know, tend to a sailboat, let alone a boat at all. I mean, so, you know.
Oh, I've seen some very impressive, and of course, you know, speaking of Lakewood Yacht Club,
really
some impressive female youth sailors.
Yeah, that's what I mean, because they're out there working and, like, they got a lot of different things going on. And it's a big responsibility. You know what I mean? That's interesting, because a lot of. Let alone guys or girls would, you know, be interested in doing that. And so when you see ladies get involved in such a eventful kind of task, I mean, they have to, like, constantly, you know, here, there, everywhere, spinning stuff. I mean, they have to listen. I mean, it's pretty hard. Yeah, absolutely. Sailing's interesting, yeah.
Yeah, no, sailing's quite a sport. So, you know, the best opportunity to witness it all is definitely the starting line. I mean, you can also get to Port A and watch them as they come in. But the starting line, you know, watch them kind of jockeying for position to get a good start. I mean, the amount of, you know, hopefully, I don't know how many boats are in this year. But like I said, I mean, some years it's been over 260 yachts. So, you know, and I've actually both participated in it, and then also I've gone out on a boat with Mark Board, that captain who we've had on the show, on a sailboat with him, just to photograph the start from the water with Galveston in the background, and had, you know, had some really, really, I mean, some of my favorite shots I've ever gotten were from that. And some of the shots that were stolen the most online and used by other people were some of those shots of mine.
Yeah, that's what you said.
There's this one shot of mine.